Hey guys, I want to start this video by telling you about Patreon. This is a membership site for creative people who want a simple way to get paid for their work. With YouTube demonetizing videos ever more frequently, it becomes harder for people like me to make a sustainable income from YouTube. So the support I get from a simple membership site like Patreon, and more importantly, from you, means that I can worry less about getting another job and more about doing what I love. Creating these videos for you. When you pledge to my channel over on Patreon, you get various rewards. For only $1, you get tons of exclusive behind-the-scenes content that you don't find anywhere else. I want to thank Aydan M, Andre Isasa, Anne Daniels, and Michael Martin for already supporting. And if you want to join too, just click the link in the description below, and I'll see you on the other side. Kyuss was one of the definitional metal bands to come out of the Palm Desert music scene back in the 80s and early 90s. And the reason for that was because their sound was so completely different compared to other metal bands at the time. If you take some of the other big metal bands at the time, like Metallica or Slayer or Megadeth, their music sounded very staccato. It was very spearheaded. While Kyuss was more slow-paced, they sounded more psychedelic and groovy and bluesy. They did borrow a lot from those genres, psychedelic rock and blues. It was quite outstanding at the time, and that's probably the reason why they grew so much in popularity in just a few short years. They released four studio albums, but decided to disband in 1996 because of artistic differences and an unstable lineup. But many of the original members of the band went on to form other bands later on as well. Kyuss did resurface under different names in the future, but these new incarnations of the band really didn't last that long, sadly. But the side effects of this short-lived act was that new communities started erupting both online and in real life. Stoner rock and desert rock is still very much alive today, even here where I'm living in Oslo, Norway. The fact that their sound still lives on to this day is a statement to how influential they really were. And that is one of the things that I really want to explore in this video, in addition to their history. So this is the brief history of Kyuss. So the band initially formed in 1987 under the name Katzenjammer, which apparently is a German word that can either mean hangover or morning cat, and you can probably decide for yourself which translation you think is the best or most fitting. They released their first EP, Sons of Kyuss, in 89, and the lineup at the time consisted of John Garcia on vocals, Josh Homme on guitars, Chris Cockrell on bass, and Brant Bjork on drums. After they self-released the EP in 1990, Cockrell decided to leave the band, and they got Nick Oliveri to fill in on bass. Now, they decided to change their name from Katzenjammer to Sons of Kyuss, and then again they decided to change it to simply Kyuss for commercial reasons. Around this time, they played a lot of local shows around in Palm Springs and Joshua Tree. They also played some shows in LA, which apparently went wrong sometimes because they got in fights. But I think they more frequently played shows in the desert during these desert fest or generator parties, as they were called. So they just brought their generator and they had electricity for everything in the middle of the desert, and they would put up a show there. No one paid any money for that, so they really had to be a good band, otherwise people would just tell them and boo them out, or it would end in a fight if they sucked, you know? So this was the perfect place for them to create their own sound, because they had to sound good, they had to sound original. Otherwise, people wouldn't allow them to play anymore. They were very lucky to get a record deal with Dolly Records during this time. This was in 91. This was also when they released their debut album, Wretch, which didn't really sell that well, but ultimately they played so many shows around in LA as well, so they started building this reputation around being a really solid live band. I can totally see why they had such an easy time creating a reputation for themselves, because they really stuck out. In LA at the time, there were a lot of hardcore punk bands, there were some early emo bands, and here you have this psychedelic blues metal-esque band that suddenly just came out of the blue, you know? In 92, they worked with producer Chris Goss to create their second album, Blues for the Red Sun, And what they aimed at with this record was to capture their live sound, because they knew they had something going for them live and they wanted to translate that into their next record. And I think they absolutely nailed that, because this record is looked upon as one of the best stoner rock, doom metal, sludge metal albums of all time. After the release of this album, their reputation grew so fast that they managed to go on tour with Metallica during their, I think they were going to tour with them throughout Australia in 93, which is quite mind-blowing for such a young band to get to such a point so fast. After the release of Blues, Nick Oliveri decided to leave the band, and he was replaced by Scott Reeder. The third album that they started working on had the working title, Kyuss. They simply wanted it to be a self-titled album, but then they swapped that for Pools of Mercury. That was supposed to be the title for some time, but then if you're a Kyuss fan, you're probably more familiar with the title Welcome to Sky Valley, which was what they ended up using for this album. This album was released in 94, and once again they had Chris Goss behind the wheel in terms of production, which again seemed to be a successful effort. Again, another band member decided to leave the band after the release of this album, and that was Brant Bjork. In an interview, he seemed to just be tired of being on the road and seeing the same faces over and over and over again in such a meticulous manner, and so he decided to leave the band. And he was replaced with one of the few other drummers from the Palm Desert music scene, which was Alfredo Hernandez. In July of 95, they released And the Circus Leaves Town, which was their fourth and final studio album before they disbanded the next year in 96. They did release a compilation album of B-sides and singles in 97, but that was the end of the Kyuss saga. Rumors started to quickly spread about whether or not they would reunite. People obviously wanted this to be a reality because people loved Kyuss at the time. Sadly, in 2004, Josh Homme did an interview with some magazine, and he completely denounced the fact that he would return in any way. But the fans received an early Christmas gift on December 20th of 2005, when ex-Kyuss vocalist John Garcia appeared on stage with Queens of the Stone Age to perform three Kyuss songs. And as you'd expect, the rumors started flaming up again. Now, the band got several offers to do one-off shows on festivals and various one-off concerts, but they never actually went on and did it, although the price for doing that, or the money that people would come up with, would sometimes reach six figures, which is crazy to think about. Ex-bassist of Kyuss, Scott Reeder, mentioned in an interview back in 2008 that he would love to do a reunion of Kyuss at some point. He knew, or at least believed, that the other members would do it as well, except for Josh Homme, obviously, who was super, super busy with his already successful band, Queens of the Stone Age. If we go back 10 years to 1997, we see that Kyuss and Queens of the Stone Age actually worked very closely together. The rest of the Kyuss band members provided help for Homme to record some of his first Queens of the Stone Age stuff, because he didn't really have a band formed at the time. During that same year, the four guys joined forces and helped Nick Oliveri, the ex-bassist of Kyuss, to record Cocaine Rodeo, a new album for his new band, Mondo Generator. Chris Goss, who had been the producer of many of Kyuss's records, also joined the team here to produce this record, and that's why a lot of fans regard this as the final Kyuss album, or Kyuss recordings, or whatever you wanna call it. There have been reunions where three quarters of the band actually reunited. For example, back in 2010, they were to reunite as Kyuss Lives, and guitarist Bruno Fieri was to take Josh Homme's place as a guitarist. After doing some touring and planning to create some more material under the name Kyuss Lives, they found out that Josh Homme, the ex-guitarist, had filed a lawsuit together with the ex-bassist Scott Reeder against their use of the name Kyuss Lives. Apparently, he thought it was too close to the original name of the band, Kyuss. Now, the ironic part here is that Brant Bjork, the guy who was still in the band in Kyuss Lives, was the guy who came up with the name in the first place. And he was the guy who Josh Homme filed a lawsuit against, in addition to the vocalist John Garcia, of course. So it's hard not to raise a brow in this case. In late 2012, court ruled against Bjorn Björk and John Garcia, and so they couldn't release any music under the Kyuss Lives title. Subsequently, they changed their name to Vista Chino, which obviously was completely different from Kyuss, but it worked. Their newly named band released their debut album, Peace, in 2013, and it sounds quite a lot like Kyuss. It sounds a little less heavy. It's more on the rock, like the hard rock side of the specter of music. But other than that, I think John Garcia's vocals is what really shines on this record, because he sounds almost identical, almost as good as on those Kyuss records, at least in my opinion. Once the album was released, they seemed to be at an all-time high in terms of their morale. But in an interview, they also highly emphasized how they had made some new enemies while doing this. Quote, "I think a lot of people, especially Josh Homme and Scott Reeder, expected us to fail. And we didn't. We're here at the other end. This is where we're supposed to be. It just took us a little bit longer to get here. And we're in a good spot. The tour is starting. We're going to be on the road up until the end of next summer. And there's already talk about another record," end quote. As I mentioned in the beginning of this video, Kyuss created a movement within rock music. Stoner rock and desert rock are still huge subcultures in today's music world that is still developing. One example of this is the YouTube channel Stoned Meadow of Doom, which is constantly, almost at a daily basis, uploading albums that relates to the genre that Kyuss was in. So that's stoner rock, desert rock, doom, sludge metal, stuff like that. And the channel has an impressive subscriber base of over 350,000 subscribers, which is crazy, and it just shows how much interest there is for this type of music still. Where I live in Oslo, Norway as well, there's a very tight and close community for stoner rock and desert rock music, which is incredible. I had no idea that this still existed up until just a year ago. It just shows how meaningful this music that Kyuss initially popularized during the 90s, how meaningful it actually still is today.
Imagine if you created a genre that was super popular and people really loved it, but you fucking hated it.
I did. My first band, there's this really wonderful thing happened. The fans took over and they own it because we stopped. And so they took it over. The fans kept it alive. And some people gave it a name, Stoner Rock.
So yeah, that's the end of this video, the brief history of Kyuss. Thank you so much for watching. Let me know in the comments down below what you think about this video and about Kyuss. Make sure you follow me on Lee Likes Music over on Instagram. I constantly try to help people create their own channels about their music scenes of their hometowns, their favorite music genres, their favorite bands. I would love to help you do exactly that. So make sure you send me a PM over on Instagram, and I would love to give you some tips on that. Again, thank you for watching, and I'll see you later. Cheers.